I said, old Samson kicked out. I wanted to say I appreciate again Sunday. All y'all was so nice. All the cards, all the notes. I got a stack of them right here from the kids that I ain't even got to look at all of them yet. And my goodness, they're so unique. One word that describes our pastor, praying. You know, it'll just say something like, once somebody put, sweet, that's a smart person. Respectful, caring, funny, radiant. I'm radiant. That was one of yours, Chanel. Where did you learn that word? But anyway, I ain't even got to read all them yet, and I appreciate y'all praying. I don't know if you realize this, but I don't ever say this. I hope you understand and you're mature enough to understand it. Sunday we had some lost people here, and realized, and I've witnessed to them, and it changed. It had an effect on my preach, especially Sunday night. I didn't even preach the sermon that I'd really planned Sunday night. I got started to talk about Adam and Eve and that fruit and stuff, and I want to tell y'all something. Whenever you hear me repeat myself and tell a story that I told about 3 months ago, please don't think I'm losing my memory. I'm not. I know exactly what I'm doing. Or please don't think that, well, my goodness, Brother Danny, I had something ready to preach. But the reason I did that is because we had people here that needed to hear that real bad. So if I turn right around and tell the same story 2 Sundays in a row, please don't think, my goodness, our preacher don't study. He told that same. There's a reason for it. When I do that, there's a reason. And we had a whole row full of folks that had never even been to Baptist church here Sunday. Been Catholic all their life. And had no idea. And they liked it. And I loaded them up with tracts and witnessed to them. And now they're gone. Who knows where? May never see them again. So I appreciate y'all's your patience with me when I do that. I'm liable to preach the same sermon 2 Sundays in a row if I think, you know, if there's 15 lost people come in here and the Lord lets me, I feel the liberty to do that, that I'm going to hit them. So y'all just bear with me when I do that. Thank you. Judges chapter 17 tonight, and we're going to look here. We're going to do 17 and 18 tonight because they run together and they're short, and then we've already done 19 and 20. On the strangest story in the Bible. So that'll only leave one more chapter, 21, next week, and we're done. We're going to do something else. I want to do some studies on why we are Baptist. I want to do some studies on some doctrine and some other things that I believe it'll really be a help to us. All right. Old Samson died. We learned a lot of lessons from Samson. And look at 17:1. I'm not even going to read all this. I'm just going to comment on it. This next two chapters revolves around a man by the name of Micah. And verse number 1 said, there was a man of Mount Ephraim whose name was Micah. And Mount Ephraim there is in central Palestine. It was up in the northern part of the tribes of Israel. And he said unto his mother, look at verse 2. This is another one of them stories. I mean, it's just over and over and over in Judges. You just keep running into them. You think, good night, that was a crazy story. And there's another one in the next chapter. And another one. And another one. It just keeps getting wilder and finally ends with that one in 19 where the guy chops his concubine up into 12 pieces and mails her out to Israel. I mean, how would you like to go to the mailbox one day and there's an elbow, you know, and blood and everything. And there's a knee. That's what he done. So there's some weird stories. But the reason they're in there like that is because the Bible said there was no king in Israel. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. And that's what happens. That's why anarchy or something. All right, verse 2. He said unto his mother. Now, this man talking to his mother, listen to this. The 1,100 shekels of silver that were taken from thee, about which thou cursest, and spake of also in mine ears, behold, the silver is with me. I took it. And his mother said, blessed be thou of the Lord, my son. Now look at this. Here this woman had 1,100 shekels of silver, and she's saving it, or she's going to do something with it. She got it put back, and her son steals it. He goes in there and finds it, and he finds it in a drawer somewhere or underneath the mattress or, you know, somewhere where they hide money. I guess all kids sneak around trying to figure out where mom and daddy hides money. Have any of y'all ever been on the bad end of that? Your kids found your money and they thought you wouldn't note it. You know, if they're smart, if you got several hundred dollars, they'll just take out a couple of them and think you don't notice. But boy, I notice, don't you? If I got $200 stuck back somewhere, I know it's $200. But sometimes the kids will do that. And this guy gets in here and he takes this money. My kin folks up in West Virginia, you know, there's 13 kids. My Aunt Cooney, my dad's sister, 13 of them. And I mean, it's just like this. Dun, 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 dun. And every one of them had white hair. I ain't talking about blonde. I'm talking white. White-haired, blue-eyed little kids. And they're just wild as they could possibly be. On my daddy's side, and they when they was growing up, you would not believe the stories they'd tell. And they had to do all kind of stuff to raise them. 13 kids in the mountains of West Virginia. I mean, in the 40s and the 50s and the 60s is when they raised all them kids. And my aunt and them, they got into some bad stuff. They sold liquor. They bootlegged. They done everything in the world. And Cooney said she did it to feed her family. Of course, they fed them really good. They had nice houses and cars and everything. They didn't have to do that. But they did. And they said their daddy was fire chief at Wig, my Uncle Wig, and they was all gone one day, and the kids were staying with the babysitter, and they said there's about eight or nine of them from 7, 8, 9 years old. They was all jumping on the bed like this, you know, a bunch of kids, and they was all jumping and playing, jumping on the bed, and one of them grabbed that thing over the top of the window like a cornice board, like a little box, you know, holds the curtains or whatever, and one of them grabbed it, and it turned over, and there was money come out of there, hit them in the head, went all of that, just $100 bills. I mean, ever. And they just said, they started going, "We're rich, woo!" And they thought, it's that old woman that used to live here. They said, it's got to be hers. And they said, we can't tell nobody. And I think Mary Ann, the oldest one, she's 12 or 13. She's the oldest one. They divided it up. They said, now you get $2,000, you get $2,000. They was all getting $3,000 and $4,000 according to age. And they paid the babysitter $1,000 not to tell her mom and dad or something like that. And, of course, come to find out, it was Wiggs. It was Wiggs' money. And they got it stole, but they found it. One time, it said Wig kept his money under the house. They none of them never don't trust no banks. I guess that's where I get it. I'm like it, too. They kept his money under the house. Mine ain't under my house. Don't come looking for it. And they kept money under the house. The river come up, and it come a flood, and it started washing under the house. And Wig sent two of his boys, Bull and Tommy Hawk. Tommy Hawk's my age. And his real name is Tommy Hawk. He's born in the back seat of a cab in Tommy Hawk, Kentucky. And they named him Tommy Hawk. His nickname is Hawkey. And I talked to him not long ago. I'm telling you, you wouldn't believe these people. They need to make my mom always said they made to make a reality show in there. It beat Honey Boo Boo all to pieces, I'm telling you. But anyway, you know, them wild, wonderful white people, those whites, don't ever watch that documentary. It ain't nothing but trash talk. I seen a couple of minutes of it, and it's just cussing. But MTV made a documentary of those, the wonderful whites of West Virginia. It's pitiful. But my family wasn't like that. They're different. But anyway, he sent them down there, and they thought that money was going to wash away, and they got it. But anyway, this boy goes in, and he takes his mom's money, and he starts feeling guilty or something, and brings it back to her and says, "Hey, Mom, you know that 1,100 shekels of silver you had? Well, about which thou cursest, well, I took it." Now, he had heard his mom cussing about it. I mean, that was a blankety blank, who got my blankety blank money? And he told her, "Mom, I got your money." And she said, "Blessed be thou the Lord, my son." Don't that strike you? Don't that strike you as kind of funny? I mean, she's a cussing one minute and a blessing the Lord You know, the Bible said that in the book of James, out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be. You ain't supposed to do that. You ain't supposed to cuss and bless out of the same mouth. But boy, you take somebody's money or beat them out of a dollar, you'll find out what kind of religion they got real quick, won't you? When you start hitting them in the pocketbook. She said, blessed be thou the Lord, my son. Now watch this, how crazy it gets. Verse 3, and when he restored the 1,100 shekels of silver to his mother said, I had wholly dedicated that silver unto the Lord. Look, from my hand, from my son, to make a graven image and a molten image. Now therefore I'll restore it unto thee. Yet he restored the money unto his mother, and his mother took 200 shekels of it and gave them to the founder. So that founder, that word found, like the founder's credit union, that's like a broker, a keeper. That founder, that word founder there in verse 4, that's a word for like a broker of handle of money, who made a graven image and a molten image, and they were in the house of Micah. Now look, people, he said, Mom, I heard you cussing about that money, so I hear I brought it back to you. And she said, blessed be thou the Lord, my son. I had wholly dedicated all this money to the Lord to build a graven image. God told, one of the Ten Commandments the Lord had given them was to make no graven images. You're starting to see how mixed up people was during this time. See how mixed up they was? They knew God, they knew who God was, and his commandment was don't make no graven image. And they said, I've given this money to the Lord to make a graven image. Now, I don't know if y'all can get what I'm trying to say or not. I hope you can understand this. But he made an image in verse 5. He had a house of gods, little g, and made an ephod, that's a shirt like the priest wore, and a teraphim, that's a statue about the size of a human being, and consecrated one of his sons who became his priest. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Here we go again. But every man did that which was right in his own eyes. So they got just enough religious beliefs to make them about half crazy, and then they mix it in with all the pagan heathen beliefs. Does that sound like anybody you know today? Don't it sound like anybody you know today who can live like the devil and star in a dirty movie and then stand and say, I want to thank God for this award? That's the same thing. That's the same thing they're doing in America now. They know about God, but they have no clue as to obeying him, following his word, taking it literal. The Lord, one of the Ten Commandments was no graven image. And they said, I dedicated all that money to the Lord. Ain't I a great Christian to build us a graven image? Make sure you don't get like that, people. Make sure you don't get like that where you're about nuts. Amen? It's like this guy said... There's a lot of them now, these so-called Christian preachers, and they go to bars on Saturday night and sit and have a drink with the boys and say, I witnessed to my friends at the bar. That's what it's like. Exactly like that. She said, let's take this money and build a graven image. Do you think the Lord was pleased with that? No. No. I don't want your graven image. I don't even want your money. I want you to get your heart right and do the right thing. See, the Lord don't want you standing up there saying, I thank God for this award, when you live like the devil and getting that award. I mean, it's like a movie or an album or an athlete getting up there and say, I just want to thank God that we won the championship and then go out and get drunk. See, it don't mix. It don't mix. So they got him, and he made him a priest. Now, that's very important. In verse number 5, he made one of his sons be the priest. A priest was supposed to come from the tribe of Levi. You couldn't just make somebody a priest. They had to be of the tribe of Levi, and they wasn't. In those days, everybody did what they thought was right. Verse 7, now this guy comes along. A young man came out of Bethlehem, Judah, verse 7, of the tribe of Judah, who was a Levite, and he sojourned there. And buddy, when they found out this guy was a Levite, look what he said, he tried to hire him. And the man departed out of the city of Bethlehem, Judah, to sojourn where he could find a place. He's just looking for a place to live. And he came to Mount Ephraim to the house of Micah as he journeyed. And Micah said unto him, Whence comest thou? And he said unto him, I am a Levite of Bethlehem, Judah, and I go to sojourn where I may find a place. So Micah said, Dwell with me and be a father unto me, a father and a priest, and I will give thee 10 shekels of silver by the year and a suit of apparel and thy victuals. You know, victuals. You know, you hear about the victuals? That's where it comes from, victuals. I don't know how they get victuals out of victuals unless the old country people didn't pronounce it right and just said victuals. So country people say victuals, but it's victuals. So the Levites went in. And the Levite was content to dwell with a man, and the young man was unto him one of his sons. And he consecrated the Levite, and he became his priest. He was in the house of Micah. Now, look back at verse 10. Notice something in verse 10. Remember what I taught y'all about the law of first mention. Here's the first time in the Bible where it said a man was called a priest and father. Right there in verse 10. There's where it started. That was the beginning of the Catholic Church. Next time you run, them Catholics always saying, ours is the oldest religion. It sure is. That's 1400 B.C. when they were calling a priest father. And it has nothing to do with God. God ain't in a million miles from it. It's a heathen practice and still is today. Still is today. They were black-robed priests called father in the Old Testament, and they worshiped the Queen of Heaven, a female deity. That became the worship of Mary. So the next time you run into a Catholic, they say, well, our religion's older than yours. So no, ours goes back to the Lord Jesus Christ. We're Christians, and yours goes back to the heathen people in the Old Testament. Sure does. And so remember that. There's the first time you see a priest called Father in Judges 17:10. Verse 13, Micah said, Now I know, look at this, the Lord will do me good, seeing I have a Levite to my priest. See, there he goes again. People are mixed up. Well, I know the Lord will bless me now because I got this Levite here. People think like that sometimes. People say, well, so-and-so's here. I've had people tell me that on an airplane. You know, the airplane, there'd be bad weather and be going through bumps and stuff. And somebody look at me and say, boy, I'm glad you're a preacher and you're on here. God won't let nothing happen to us if you're on here. I said, well, I appreciate that, but I'm just as scared as you are. You know, he said, the Lord's going to bless me because I got this Levite to be my priest. Yes, sir, I'll hang around with old brother so-and-so, and the Lord will bless me. That ain't the way it works. He really thought that. Now, in chapter 18, let's get this one right quick, and we'll go. In those days, here we go again. Verse 1, there was no king in Israel. In those days, the tribe of the Danites, that's Dan, tribe of Dan, sought an inheritance to dwell in, for unto that day all their inheritance had not fallen unto them among the tribes of Israel. And the children of Dan, that always bothers me because that's my name, Dan, part of my name. And the name Dan means God is my judge. And that tells me, I tell people that. Daniel, Dan, my name, Danny, means God is my judge. And I've told people that before. You know, the Lord's my judge, and he'll judge me one day. And he is my judge. And the tribe of Dan, they had some problems here. The men of valor from Zoar to Eshtaol to spy out the land, and they went to look for a place to live, and they came to Ephraim to the house of Micah and lodged there. Verse 3 said, And they were by the house of Micah. They knew the voice of the young man, the Levite, who turned in thither, and they said, How'd you get here? Where'd you come from? And he said, verse 4, I'm his priest. Verse 5, and he said, well, ask counsel of God that we may know whether our way shall be prosperous or not. And the priest said unto them, Go in peace before the Lord is your way wherein you go. That's another weird thing. Here's this priest that ain't even supposed to be a priest, that ain't even right with God, and then these people come to him and they say, Oh, you're a priest? Well, ask God, is it his will that we go down here such and such and such and such? And he looked back at him and said, Yes, it is the will of God. Go with God's blessings. Now look, was the Lord in that? He wasn't in a million miles of that. Even if it was right. You listening? Even if it was right. Did you know you can get hooked up with spirits that'll tell you stuff that's right. I believe the Bible said in the last days people give heed to seducing spirits. I believe a lot of times people read cards or read palms or stuff really do get advice, but it ain't coming from God. God don't give advice through tarot cards or regular cards or lines in your hand. That ain't the way the Holy Ghost works. The Holy Ghost will work through His Word. Beware of people that are saying, listen, a Christian ain't got no business even reading your astrology. I don't even read them stupid fortune cookies. I don't. When I get one, I break it open and throw a little paper away and eat it because it'll mess with your head if you read that stuff. It's going to say, oh, great things are in your future. Well, you might be going to break your neck tomorrow. You will find true love. Yeah, right. Heard that before, ain't you? One man said, he played cards or asked tarot cards or something. He said, bet on lucky lady, horse, and won like $10,000. So he asked the Ouija board. He's playing with the Ouija board. And he asked the Ouija board, said, what shall I do about this? And the Ouija board did do this, and it worked out good. And then he said, when shall I plant my crops? And the Ouija board said, plant your crops on this day. And he planted them on that day, and his crops was good, and the other people's died. He's getting hooked. And then he said, asking another question, he said, what shall I do about this? And the Ouija board said, do this, and it was right. And then he said, what should I do now? And the Ouija board said, kill your dog. See, it's taking him step by step by step. And he killed his dog because he trusted that spirit. And couldn't find out the dog had rabies. And he said, see there? So he messed with it again. What should I do now? He said, kill your son. And then you feel like, whatever this is that's telling me to do this, I better listen to it because it's been right every time. See how it gets you? That's some spooky stuff, y'all. And you start messing around with cards, I don't think you ought to mess around with anything occultic, superstitious, no Ouija board. No, it's not just fun and games. A real spirit can get you in that stuff. I mean, anything like, I think Harry Potter is witchcraft 101. I don't think it's harmless. I don't think any of the movies like that are harmless. I mean, there's a spirit comes through them, can get in your kids, can cause rebellions. I think our kids are naturally attracted to what's evil, naturally by their flesh. Yes, sir. No, I didn't hear that, but I wouldn't doubt it. You wouldn't believe the stuff they do. You wouldn't believe it. And we sit here and we say, oh, anybody's crazy to do something like that. And they are. But you dibble-dabble around and stuff like that. You dibble-dabble around. And then you're high or drunk or something, and the devil put all kinds of things in your head. You'd be surprised what the devil put in your head. If you listen to him one thing, something else, something else, something else, something else. Next thing you know, he's got you doing something you didn't ever think you'd do. Happens every day. Young people, adults, a little bit here, a little bit here. Compromise a little here, compromise a little here. A little music, a little fun, a little this, a little that. Next thing you know, I never believed I would have gotten this mess. The devil's smart. That's right. Yeah. You sure can. See, the Bible said in the last days you'll give heed to seducing spirits. Seducing spirits. That's where we are today. That's where we are today. Madonna and all them people say they're Christians. Now, something's wrong somewhere. I ain't nobody's judge, y'all, but something's wrong somewhere. I mean, they said Somebody said her two favorite songs are Like a Prayer and Like a Virgin, two subjects she knows nothing about. But you know what? That's what they did here in the book of Judges. Now, let's finish this up right here. We're going to have to hurry here. So anyway, they're looking for him. And they're trying to get him a priest and in verse 7, them people dwelt careless. See, it says careless. That means without care. That's where we get the word careless. And quiet and secure. And they wasn't doing nothing. And they went and burned them, man. And burned them up or killed a bunch of people like that. Let's skip on down. I mean, the verse number 10. He said, when you go, you'll come to a people secure and a large land, for God given it in your hands, a place where there is no want of anything that is in the earth. And they went down and they found this place, and five men went out to spy it in verse number 14. And they went back and got in verse 17, the five men that went to spy out the land went and came thither and took the graven image and the ephod and the teraphim and the molten image, and the priest stood in the entering of the gate with the 600 men that were appointed with weapons of war. Verse 18, and these went into Micah's house and fetched, there's an old country word, fetched, good Bible word, the carved image, the ephod and the teraphim, the molten image, and said, what do you do? And they said, put your hand on your mouth. The people's heart was glad, and they turned and departed. And look at verse 22, another old saying. Here's your Bible coming to life again. And when they were a good way from the house, you ever heard the old people say that's a good ways off? That's a good ways off. That's where it come from. That King James Bible's full of stuff like that. They overtook them, and they cried. Look at verse 23. You don't see another one? And they turned their faces and said, what aileth thee? Verse 24, what aileth thee? Have you ever heard him? The old folks said, what ails you? I'm feeling terrible. Well, what ails you? That comes out of the Bible. You know why they say that down south? Because people down south read the Bible. They don't say it up north, not because they're more educated, but because the Catholic Church kept the Bible away from them people. Amen. Don't ever let nobody make fun of you for talking Bible language. What ails you? Fetch? South? Nothing wrong with it. Somebody sent me a text the other day, said, it was the night before Christmas, and all through the house, the AC was running because we live in the South. I hope we have a nice Christmas. But anyway, they said, what ails you? In verse 25, the children of Dan said, don't let your voice be heard. And Micah saw the children of Dan. Look at verse 26. He saw that they were too strong for him. He turned and went back to his house. Now, I just want to stop there just a second. We're going to be through. I want to stop there just a second. Here's Micah. He makes all these false gods. He makes all these stuff, and he tries to worship God with them, and this bunch of people comes in and steals it and takes it all off, and he realizes they're too strong for him. They stole his God, and he just goes back to his house and sits down. Wonder what he went and said. Wonder how he felt. Here's a man goes home and sits down and says, they stole my gods. They stole the ephod. They stole the terror. They stole all my religion. Listen, people, that's a good lesson right there. Make sure you got something people can't steal. We talked about the Catholic Church there a while ago. Did you know that you could take just about every bit of religion a Catholic person has away from them? You can take their beads, the candles, the crosses, the communion stuff, or what they call it, the body of Christ, transubstantiation. You could take all that, and they wouldn't have nothing left. Think about us. Think about it. You can't get my religion. You couldn't take my religion. You couldn't. You say, well, we'll burn this church down. Ain't got nothing to do with it. We can sit out there. I worship God today at my house. You say, well, I'll get your Bible. I got it hidden in my heart. I don't know all of it, but I know enough to where I could quote enough to keep me going. I got it hidden in my heart. Amen? You say, well, we'll just throw all your songbooks away. We got the songs memorized. Amen. If you burnt this place down and took everything we got, you still can't get what we've got. It's in here. That's why you know you got the real thing. It's inside. That's why they killed them, them martyrs. They couldn't get their religion. They took everything this guy had. Have you ever thought about this? If somebody can take your God and destroy it, what kind of God is that? He said he made him a God. What kind of God is it you have to make? I've never understood, and there's still people in the world, in other countries, in tribes, and in the jungles and stuff. They make gods. Wouldn't it register in your head after a while, if I made this, it ain't God I am. You can't make something greater than yourself. You can't, if you make it, it ain't God. You made it. Nobody made God. God has no beginning, no ending. You don't make a God. You might make something and worship it like it's a God, but it ain't God. Now look here what he said here, and we'll be done. And they, in verse 27, they came and smote the edge of that with a sword and burnt that city with fire. And them people ain't done nothing wrong. There was no deliverer. Everybody's crazy, just doing whatever they want to. If they wanted your stuff, they'd just burn your house down and take it. There was no law. There was no, and that's exactly the way America's getting. These riots, these out in the streets, people busting in store windows, grabbing TVs, running on. You know, it's lawless. It's lawless. That's the way they got here in the book of Judges. Verse 29, we'll be through. And they named the city Dan after the name of Dan their father, who was born to Israel. Howbeit the name of the city was Laish at the first. And the children of Dan set up the graven image. And Jonathan, the son of Gershom, the son of Manasseh, he and his sons were priests to the tribe of Dan till the day of the captivity. That was a long time. And they set them up Micah's graven image, and he made all the time that the house of God was in Shiloh. I can't understand how that they set this graven image up and say, you're our priest, we worship God, and God said, don't make no graven image. It's the same thing today. People do absolutely opposite of what God said and still say, I'm a Christian, I love Jesus. Same thing. We're seeing the days of Judges come alive. Now, we covered 19 and 20 on the strangest story in the Bible. If you wasn't here, you missed it. We've done that on Sunday night. So 21, we'll finish next week. Okay? Any questions? See the parallels. Said what now? Oh, yeah, right. The Lord has blessed me because of him being there. Yeah, that's true. That's true, yeah. You hang around the right people, the Lord bless you. You hang around the wrong people, you get in trouble with them. Hang around the right people, you get blessed. You get their blessings flow over on you. All right, let's stand, we'll pray. Hey, we're going to have every head bowed, every eye closed. Miss Desi, come if you would, please. And I want to search your heart. I wonder tonight, if you make sure you're right. Make sure you don't just say, I'm a Christian. Make sure you say, hey, I'm not only a Christian, but I'm going to go by what the Bible said and worship God in spirit and in truth. I'm not just going to say, well, I'm a Christian, and I've got graven images, and I've got false gods and everything else in the world, but I'm going to honor God in my life. Let's pray that right now. Dear Lord, please, I pray right now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, touch our hearts, God, we pray. Lord, I pray for every one of us that we won't just be a Christian in word, but in deed and in truth. Thank you for this little time together tonight of encouragement. Lord, our faith has been encouraged, and Lord, we'll never cease to be amazed at what we see in your word. Lord, it's just on and on and on and on. We thank you for putting the book of Judges in the Bible so we could learn from it, Lord, and be encouraged by it. Now, have you in our hearts this evening. God bless everyone as they go home. Bless them for coming to church tonight. We'll praise you and thank you for what you do now. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his sake, thank you, Lord. Amen. 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 Amen.